So let me begin today's discussion. What we do now is we have been studying about the a programmable logic device. So so let me finish up that portion. So if you recall, programmable logic device, we have studied about field programmable logic array and then PROM, PROM. Okay, in field programmable logic array, both the AND array and the OR array are programmable. That means you can selectively originally all the fuses are there, and then you tend to blow away some of the fuses depending on the functions that you have to realize. In PROM, however, the AND array is fixed. That means all possible product terms are provided to you, and you as a designer can select one or many of these to realize the function. One very major thing, important thing, please try to remember, is that the product terms can be shared. Okay, can be shared in the amongst more than one function. For example, if you see f1, f2, f3, this is an example where three functions are realized using the PROM technology. So you see that the min term m6 a b c bar is shared among f1 f2 f3. Okay, we need not generate this term more than once. Once it is generated in the AND array, and subsequently it can be shared in the OR array by f1 f2 f3. Okay, all three functions. Okay, and similarly in FPL also it is there. However, the technology that we shall study now, namely PAL, okay, that is called programmable array logic. Okay, PAL. So here the AND array is programmable and the OR array is fixed. Okay, so this is one symbolic way of showing the configuration of PAL. AND array is programmable and OR array is fixed. So it means that on the OR array, each output function, say O1 for example, it can be, and O2 also, it can be generated in terms of only the specified set of product terms. Okay, you will not get all possible product terms. Then the number of product terms will be quite limited. Okay, as the OR array is fixed, okay, OR array is fixed, the PL or programmable array logic representation, we are showing on, this is a separate diagram. Okay, so here this particular form of representation is more commonly used than the above one. For example, here I can see that O1 and O2 are two output functions. O1 is generated in terms of two distinct product terms. Similarly, O2 in terms of two other distinct set of product terms. But remember, if one of the product terms belongs in common to both O1 and O2, they need to be generated twice. Okay, remember, most important thing in PL is that no product term can be shared among more than one output functions. Okay, right? So the way PAL or programmable array logic, which consists of fixed OR array. Okay, please remember, the OR array is fixed. You cannot do anything about this. Okay, whereas the AND array is programmable. In PL, actually the applications are more limited compared to field programmable logic array and PROM, programmable read-only memory. Okay, so here what we do, each output function need to be generated only in terms of the given set of product terms. So a very limited set of product terms is given to us as designer. So it is our duty to see first whether the required number of product terms for a particular application satisfy the criterion of the worst case possible number of product terms, which is provided by the manufacturer, okay, from the factory. So as we see here, suppose this is a variety of PL that is given to us, it has come from the manufacturer's house. So we understand that each output function should be able to consist of not more than three product terms. So if for our application any output function consists of three or less number of product terms, we can easily make use of that. But if in case the output function that we want to generate consists of more than three product terms, suppose for our output application we require five product terms, okay, for a particular output function, and we however find that the manufacturer allows us to generate output function using maximum of three product terms, then what we'll do? Any suggestion? The question is that suppose the manufacturer says that I am giving you a PAL configuration, there each output function can be at most consist of three product terms. However, we want to utilize the particular PL for our, and also let me tell you that many number of output functions you can generate. However, the limitation is that each output function will consist of maximum at most three product terms. So suppose for our application we require, say adder, we require four product terms. Can you work with a PL in that case? What is your answer? Anyone? Aditya? Whoever? What do you think? Aishik? Aishwarya?
Any idea? Feedback could be available then.
So very good answer. Okay. So that means you require the mechanism of feedback, right? So that means one, you can split the output function into two. Let us say O1 equal to O11 plus O12. O11 consists of three product terms. O12 consists of the other three. That means O11 will take up the sum of the three AND products. It is fed back from the OR array to the AND array. Okay, so that sum now becomes a single sum expression that along with the two remaining ones can give you, that means O12 plus this particular say O11 which consists of three product terms, O11 plus say P5 and P6 will give you O2, okay, or the O1, original O1, okay, clear. So very good answer. So that means bidirectional input output along with feedback mechanism should be provided to us, then we can solve the problem. Now let us take up a few examples where we can realize switching functions using PAL device. PAL stands for PAL, the full form is programmable array logic. So given functions are these. There are four variable logic functions. Okay, so the first logic function consists of these many mean terms and these many don't cares. Similarly F2, similarly F3. Now remember, as we have said, that in PL technology we cannot share any product term among more than one functions. Okay, so if you require, for example, here you find looking at the, if you inspect the algebraic form of the three functions, do you find existence of any product term which is common to more than one function? For example, look at F1 and F3. Here A bar, B bar, D bar is common to both. Okay. Also, if you look between F1 and F2, B bar, C, D bar is common between F1 and F2. But we cannot generate once A bar, B bar, D bar, and then feed the same same product term line between F1 and F2. That is not permitted. If you have to generate A bar, B bar, D bar twice, okay, and then feed it to F1 once and then F3. Similarly, B bar, C, D bar, you have to generate once for F1, another time for F2. Okay, you cannot generate it only once and then share between more than one function. It was possible, remember, it was possible in the case of FPLA and PROM. So that is the chief difference between PL and PROM and FPLA. Okay, so PAL is limited for those applications where the number of input variables can be many, but the number of product terms should be limited. Okay, there should not be many, only a few. Okay, now sometimes we definitely have those applications also, and we can then make use of PAL. So remember that the application of PAL is quite limited. Now, on the other hand, PAL allows us to do area optimization. PROM does not allow us. Okay, PROM actually generate all the power terms, so size of the end terms is quite huge. Okay, in FPLA also we have to run. See here, one thing I should tell you that PL, as it does not allow us to share product terms between more than one functions, so you can use Quine-McCluskey minimization independently for the three functions here, for whatever functions are there. But there is one version of Quine-McCluskey that is called multiple output Quine-McCluskey minimization, which do the minimization for all the specified functions collectively, okay, taking into account the shared product terms. But here that version you cannot use. You have to apply Quine-McCluskey algorithm, but individually to different functions, not to more than one functions at a point of time, okay, because you cannot share product terms. So in this case, independent function of say this form of F1 ABCD, where we have indeed made use of the provided don't care terms and then obtain this, that means F1 in minimized form will consist of these three product terms. F2 will be consisting of these two product terms, and F3 will be consisting of these three product terms. Note that F1 can be realized in this form. Okay, AND array is programmable, remember, only AND array, not the OR array. Okay, so F1 must consist of three product terms. Now, which product terms you will take, that will depend on you as a circuit designer. So you have taken care that P1 should be A bar, B bar, D bar, P2 should be B bar, C, D bar, and P3 should be B, C, D. And these three are ORed and fed to the final output function. Note that for F2, it requires only two product terms. However, what you will do with the third product term, which is already provided? So what you do, you just allow all the fuses corresponding to the third product term to remain. If you allow all the fuses to remain in that particular term, particular row or column, so what will happen, the P6 here, for example, if all the fuses are allowed to remain intact, what value it will give? P6, will it give logic 1 or logic 0? That means all the fuses are remaining intact, none of them is blown up.
It will be 0.
Very good. So P6 will be 0, and if you add 0 to any Boolean sub-expression, the original sub-expression value remains unchanged. That's what we require. So we can, whatever, if we exceed the number of product terms in the provided number of product terms, the unused ones, we can just allow all the fuses to remain intact. Okay, thereby we can implement the three output functions within the given constant. Okay, right. And as you have seen, in some case, if it is not allowed to make use of only three, but say you require more than three, then you can use the facility. Normally, it will be given. For PLA as well as PAL, the facility of using bidirectional mechanism, bidirectional input output will definitely be there, and you can make use of the shortage. Okay. So now what we do? Yes. Very good. Please ask question.
Sir, if there are common terms, then why can't we use an external OR gate? That would minimize the expression further, right?
If there are more
external
than
OR gate. Yeah, common terms.
Okay, common terms mean you want to use external OR gate. Yes. So, okay, that is another mechanism. That means you want to, I understand. F1, F2, suppose it has got one sub-expression, say consisting of two or more, even one, whatever, two or three common mean terms. What you can do, you can separately combine them using one of the provided functions, okay, and then you can feed it back as another product. That you can do. Yes. That is a good suggestion. I understand. Suppose he's saying, suppose here the limitation is 3, maximum number of 3, but suppose F1 consists of 5, F2 consists of 6, okay, so, or say both F1 and F2 consist of 5. Now F1 and F2 has common product terms of 3. What we can do, those three product terms which are common to F1 and F2, we can generate a sub-expression ORing the three. Then you can generate in the OR array, feed it back into the AND array, and connect it with the remaining product terms of F1 and the remaining separate product terms of F2. Okay, that thereby you can do, right? That means you have to work under the given limitations without making use of any external AND gate or OR gate. So what should be convenient to us is that the mechanism for feeding back output term generated in the OR array back to AND term should be provided. That mechanism will be urgently required. Okay, good. So now what we do, we take a leave of this topic. Okay, right. So all of you please remember, I will send you a mail also, that 31st October, the Saturday, in the slots of tutorial, we can have the class test, right? All of you please be prepared, right? On that day, you should be all coming prepared for the exam. Okay, so I'll send you the questions. So you will answer them. You write it in A4 sheets of paper. Okay, and then you can take scan and you can upload to backpack or other mechanism. But anyway, so I'll send out details for that. So remember, 31st October, Saturday, 3:30 to 5 o'clock, the exam will be there. Okay, all of you, please remember. Now, we go over to study multiplier. Multiplier, remember, multiplier is perhaps more important than adder. Okay, multiplication, where is it required? In the next semester, you'll study about the digital signal processing course. So there, you'll study about multiplier, accumulator, MAC we talk about. Okay, so multiplier, accumulator, combination. So multiplication is very much necessary in digital filter applications. Also, any application you talk about, any mathematical function you talk about, multiplication is an integral part of different Boolean function. Arithmetic computation. So multiplication should be. We need to know how to a bit of multiplier circuits. Not the optimized one, but the simple ones. So multiplication is considered is much more is substantially more complex than addition. We have studied about addition. Okay, use of a positional notation for numbers. You see, positional number system, all of us are familiar with. So if you take up positional number system for specifying the operands for multiplier, so that reduces the multiplication to n addition, where n is a number of bits in the multiplier, and similarly for the multiplicand also. So let multiplicand be y and multiplier be x. So if multiplier is x and it has the bits, the decimal, the binary digits or bits, say the least significant one is x0, the most significant one is xn-1, and the weightage is also given as powers of 2, then we can write the decimal equivalent of x as xn-1 multiplied by 2^n-1, and so on. Okay, now when we need to compute the product of x and I, where x is the multiplier, n bit multiplier, and y is n bit multiplicand, then it will look like this. Look at the expression, the second expression. That means this is the desired product. X multiplied by y will give me, this is bitwise we are taking from the multiplier, one bit from multiplier, xn-1, and this is the entire multiplicand. Again, x2 is a single bit from the multiplier, y is the complete multiplicand. So what we have here is that the entire multiplication up to n bit operands is reduced to n-1 addition. So that means number of additions should be n-1 less. You can convince yourself by putting say n equal to 2. If you put n equal to 2, then x1 into y into 2^1 plus x0 into y into 2^0. So you have got 1. n-1 will be 1. N equal to 2. So you require one addition of n bit operands and n multiplication. Why n? Because here one multiplication, here another multiplication. Okay, so here the multiplication will consist of multiplying with a single bit of the multiplier with the entire multiplicand. Clear? So you are now convinced about this statement. That means the multiplication of two n bit operands is reduced to n-1 additions of n bit operands and n multiplications of an n bit multiplicand by a single bit multiplier xi. Now, obviously, as you are multiplying a word with a single bit, okay, the operation reduces to making use of only AND operation. That I believe it is clear. Okay, so suppose XI is a multiplier bit, and you have got the entire multiplicand consist of the Y0, Y1, Y2, YN-2 and YN-1, the N bits of the multiplicand. Then as you are trying to compute the partial product, that means Y multiplied with Y X0 or X1, whatever. So individually X0 will be ANDed with Y0, then X0 will be ANDed with Y1 and so on. Okay, so you require N number of two input AND gates. So obviously the AND operator will be required. Now I show you here, you see that it is a more concrete. So what if you require a large number of multiplier elements, which we have denoted as M, what it consists of within the box? If you look upon the multiplier element as a black box, you see these are the inputs and these are the outputs. So how many inputs are there? There are four inputs, mind you: XI, the multiplier bit; YJ, the multiplicand bit, okay, and then the carry input; and ZI from the top. Okay, so what they produce, see ZI, Y, it is carried from the top. This will be made clear when I take help of this multiplying to 4-bit numbers, and I will show you definitely the complete digital implementation of such a 4x4-bit multiplier. That means the multiplier consists of 4 bits, multiplicand consists of 4 bits, and the final product will consist of 8 bits. Okay, so this 8-bit product will be composed by multiplying to 4-bit numbers. Okay, that means multiplicand has this configuration: Y3, Y2, Y1, Y0. Y3 is the most significant bit, Y0 is the least one. And for the multiplier, X3, X2, X1, X0, this is the multiplier. X3 is the most significant bit, X0 being the least significant bit. So this 4-bit number I am trying to multiply with this, and then finally the result that should be generated is a 8-bit product. Okay, Z7, Z6, Z5, Z4, Z3, Z2, Z1, Z0. This is the 8-bit product that will be generated. Okay, now although I am writing ZI, it does not mean that I am talking about a single bit from the final one. No, that is actually what it will be made more clear when I show you the configuration. That means a large number of these multiplier elements will be required. So for generating an 4x4-bit multiplication, can you tell me how many such multiplication elements are required? Let me talk about in this fashion, that this is what we do on pen and paper, right? Okay, so on pen and paper, what we do, we are more used to doing the product of two decimal numbers. Okay, say 36 multiplied by 53. In that case, what we do, 36 is the multiplicand, 53 is the multiplier. So what we do first, we multiply out 36 with 3. Okay, that gives me 108. So right in this position, and then 53, so 53, that means 5 has a relative weightage of 10 with respect to 3. It means 5 into 10 plus 3. So when we are computing the partial product of 5 and 36, we'll place it leaving a decimal position vacant. We shift it towards the left. Why? Because we know that the relative weight of 5 is 10 with respect to 3. So when we are writing the partial product of 3 with 36, we write it here. For 5, we are shifting it towards the left and then adding them up, right? That's what we do. Okay, here what we'll do is that bitwise the multiplier, okay, say X0 is the multiplier bit, there will be 4 multiplier elements. Okay, so in one multiplier element, X0 will be multiplied by Y0, and of course here Zeta is 0, because what is being taught, nothing, it's 0. But for the sake of generality, we have to put this multiplier elements in multiple numbers. Okay, so there Zeta equal to 0. What is YI? Whatever the value of YJ, Y0 actually. Then carry input will be 0 for this case. And what are the outputs produced? Because you see FA stands for full adder. Okay, dear friends, please understand that FA, I have written cryptically, concisely, it means full adder. So full adder has got three inputs, add in augend and the carry input, and produces two outputs, Z0, C0. So final output from this M box, this multiplier element is 2. Okay, one sum, one carry output, because ultimately it is a full adder. But the total number of inputs is 4, and it involves an AND gate also, right? So this AND product is fed as addend or augend, whatever. This is the addend or augend. This is a carry input. Okay, and finally you produce two outputs out of each multiplier element. So here, for example, I have to put a M, then another M, then another M, then another M. Okay, clear, right? So then what we do here, the carry input will be 0. Now let me ask you one question. If I show you this, the way we have shown this in a, that means as if four rectangles are placed, one each on top of another. And when we are going to the next higher significant multiplier bit x1 with respect to x0, x0 is a least significant bit. So its product is produced here. And then we are showing the partial product in a concise manner. We are putting this rectangle, but with a shift of one position towards the left. We understand that the partial product weightage of this with respect to the previous, say we call it to be PP1. The previous partial product is PP0. We'll add up PP0 and PP1. So PP1, its relative weight with respect to PP0 will be 2. Okay. And then we'll form the partial product, say X2. So here the PP2, its relative weight with respect to PP1 is 2, whereas PP2's relative weight with respect to PP0 will be 2 square. Okay. And finally PP3. So how many total multiplier elements you require? Quickly. See, multiplier element means this is the element, and what are the required inputs and outputs I've told you. So one will be the one multiplier bit, one other will be one multiplicand bit. This will come from its neighbor on top, and this is come from its neighbor on its right. Okay, so what it produces? It will produce one carry output and one sum output. So it will be fed as successive another multiplier element, both this one and this one. Now my question is, how many multiplier elements do you think I require if I got to multiply out one multiplicand, 4-bit multiplicand with a 4-bit multiplier? Quick, can you tell me?
So 16.
16.
Very good, very good. Who is this? What is your name? Anyway, so I think Janeshwaran, no? Okay, very good answer. Now, this concept I'll show you schematically in the above figure, displaying the weights, powers up to as appropriate shifts of the multiplicand. Now, let me show you the total structure. So I'll require this 16 multiplier elements. See how the data is fed. So here, the raw data, that means the primary inputs are one multiplier number, what consisting of 4 bits, x3, x2, x1, x0, and multiplicand, 4-bit multiplicand consisting of y3, y2, y1, y0. Okay, and they are made incident on a distinct set of multiplier elements. Clear? Just see. This is one multiplier element. Here the carry input is 0. Y0 is fed, X0 is fed. Now within this, there is a AND gate. Okay, please do not forget about the presence of the AND gate. This ANDing will be required, bitwise product. Okay, so there is a AND gate. Follow it up with a full adder where X0, Y0, this AND product will be incident. This 0 will be incident. Okay, and this 0 will be incident, and it will produce a sum. It will produce a carry output. Clear? So these four, the first partial product, we call it to be PP0. PP0 means what? We are the result of multiplying out this 4-bit multiplicand with X0, the least significant bit of multiplier, and that produces PP0. Okay, and this is produced by these four multiplier elements. The result you now show is coming to the next row. Okay, next row at the bottom of this PP0. So PP1, you see how it is computed. So as before, X1 is is floated is propagated to each of the multiplier elements as one of the units, as one of the inputs. For the rightmost aim, the input is zero, carry input. But here it is not so. Remember, here it can be one as well. Here it can be one as well. Here it can be one as well. Only for the rightmost column, all the carry inputs are zero. Okay. Similarly, for the topmost row only, these are zeros. Not for the henceforth whatever multiplier elements you encounter as you proceed towards row after row and you go down, not necessarily this will be zero, right? This can be one as well. Okay, I hope you have understood. So in general, we have to keep the multiplier elements where the four inputs should be introduced within the multiplier elements. One is carry input, one is the one multiplier bit, one multiplication bit. They produce, I mean, they are incident on an AND gate, their result, and whatever is fed from the top, that is fed as an input to the full adder, and it produces the full adder, one carry output, one sum out. Okay. So in general, we have to put the same, means internally all the multiplier elements are same, and we require no less than 16. Okay. So please try to understand the data flow. So here the data is flowing like that. Okay. So this will take care of the partial product PP1. This will take care of the partial product PP2, and this will take care of the partial product PP3. And see that what I have done, you see that Z0 is coming here directly without any. So Z0 is what? Pure and simple, just ending of X0, Y0. It's coming. Okay, because X0, Y0 is summed up with 0 as carry input and 0 from top. So obviously the same thing. But it has been generated from the full adder output. Okay, Z1. Has required some pull adder. It can be somewhat either 0 or 1 depending on the values. Then Z2 is coming, there Z3, Z4, Z5, Z6. Each of the addition will give me 4 bit along with the carry. So Z7 is nothing but the result of some carry output. I hope it is clear. No, Z7 is some carry output. Just look at this, you will get similarly. So Z7 is coming up. This is a sum bit, this is a carry output. For each of the multiplication, okay, you see, I'm showing the sum is coming down in a in a diagonal fashion, okay, in an inclined way, and carry output is going towards the left. For each of the multiplier element, all of you please see that the output emanating from the multiplier element will consist of one sum bit and one carry out bit. So sum bit will be coming down to the next row, whereas the carry output is going to the left neighbor in the same row. Clear? I believe there is no doubt. If any doubt, just please let me know. I'll have to explain one thing. Don't worry. So I have written for your convenience also. It is evident from the figure that full multipliers require a large amount of circuitry. Okay. That I believe you have appreciated. That if I have to see, multiplication is inherently more complex than addition. Okay. So each for multiplication, we require complete number of multiplier elements. For accurate calculation, I'll require for computing the product of two 4-bit numbers, no less than 16 multiplier elements. So the circuitry that is consumed will be quite considerable, right? Quite substantial, huge. I mean, if you now I am talking about, say, 4 by 4 bit. Suppose I talk about 16 by 16, then I will get 256 number. Okay, and each of the multiplier elements. So imagine that total number of adders, pull adders, and total number of AND gates. So lot of circuitry you require. So if you, I mean, but what is the benefit? Benefit is that I'll get the output at one go. Okay, without the need of any saving or storage. I do not require any flip-flop. I do not require any register. I just feed in the multiplier, feed in the multiplication, get the data totally at the desired points. So here I find that the 8-bit data will be provided, 8-bit product will be given to us at the output of this M, this M, this M, this M, this M. So that means this the bottommost row and the rightmost column will provide me the entire output, the product, right? I have to just put the logic analyzer at the proper points to understand that what are the values of the individual bits of the 8-bit product. I hope it is clear, all of you. Any doubt? Okay. So as it consumes huge amount of circuitry, so normally they are normally realized as a sequence of additions. That means we we take a back seat as far as the time is concerned. We take more time, but the hardware will become simpler. This is the most expensive hardware, let me tell you, but it provides the product in the least amount of time without the necessity of any register, any flip-flop, any storage elements involved. However, what we do is that we can make use of some storage, okay, and then do it sequentially. So obviously, when you have to do it something sequentially, some intermediate values need to be stored, and that will be reused in the next sequence. Okay, the next step of the sequence. So normally, multiplier, if we have a crunch of the resources, if the hardware is at premium, we cannot use as many as we require. So they are normally realized as a sequence of additions executed sequentially in time. The exceptions are computers specifically designed for numerical computations, say for weather prediction or for there are certain applications where the time is at a premium. You need to generate the multiplication quite fast. So then such expensive hardware will be tolerated. Okay. So its heavy expenses will be allowed, justified. Now I ask you one question. The circuit becomes even more complex when measures for speeding up carry propagation. You saw for carry look at propagation, right? So the circuit is somewhat complex. Now in this particular circuit, the longest carry path, how much? Let me ask you the question. You have seen that carry out is generated here. Can you tell me where lies the longest carry path propagation?
So 12.
Achha, why? Can you show the path? You said 12.
So first row, then diagonal, and then last row.
Okay, first row, then diagonal, the last, very good. So here I find that how many elements it is passing through is not 12, but less than that. Why? You see, the signal is entering here, okay, as also entering here. So from that, it will go through an AND gate, then a full adder. Full adder means, let us say, for simplicity, it's a two-level AND/OR. So that means the signal is passing through three gates while it passes through multiplier element and coming out on the left end generated as a carry out. Clear? So you see how many gates it passes through when it traverses through a single multiplier element. It is three. All of you are convinced? Okay, because see, an AND gate and this full adder, I have not shown the details, but all of you are well aware of the construction of full adder. It will consist of two number of simple AND or product. Okay. So that means two-level circuit. I require an AND gate, then an OR gate. So that means it requires total from here to here, it requires three-level circuit. One AND gate, then followed by one, say, three-input AND gate, followed by a four-input OR gate. Clear? Any doubt? So that means the signal is passing to three levels of gates and one element. See, 1M, 2M, 3M, 4M, then it takes the diagonal 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay. So it is 10 multiplier elements, not 12. Okay. And then each of the multiplier element, the signal is passing through, is going through three gates. So that means overall, how many gates the signal has to pass through from here to here? That means when Z7 is produced, X0 and Y0, they have also got a role, right? X0, Y0, not as such, but we have to calculate the signal propagation delay. So from here to here, it is passing. That means I have to wait for some time, then gate delay. So suppose, say, 5 nanosecond for each of the gate. This is blindly, I say. So that means 15 nanosecond delay will be presented here, will be required, involved. Then again 15, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So 10 multiplier elements, and each of the multiplier element will involve a delay of 30 nanoseconds. So 30 into 10, 300 nanosecond delay will be there. So this is the worst case carry propagation. All of you, please be convinced. So this is one path is I am showing, but that is not the only path for longest carry propagation. Say here to here, right? You can go via some other, say 1, 2, then 3. Okay, zigzag you go, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Or I go like this, 1, 2, 3, then I take a bottom path, 4, then I go zigzag, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So whatever path you take from this end, you come to Z7, you will find, you will encounter multiple number of longest carry propagation, and that will involve 10 multiplier elements or 30 gates. So are you convinced now? Dear friend, I mean, whoever answered for 12, okay. So it will require 10 multiplier elements, not 12, clear, or 30 gates. Now, use of carry propagation is therefore advisable in such cases. Now, let us study a bit about some mechanism, some algorithm which gives us less hardware, but we have to understand the algorithm very properly. So this is the very straightforward way of implementing, as we do on pen and paper. But if you have to do it in a hardware, economic hardware, then we have to pay more attention. We have to understand. So that's why I now require your attention very well. I mean, I know that you, all of you are very attentive. So just go with me. So far, any doubt? Okay. So see that now we'll be looking for circuitry which will be more economical in hardware, but we have to understand the algorithm very well. So using a combinational circuit to obtain product at once requires substantial circuit, number of digits being like, say, n equal to, say, 32. Then it will be consuming huge amount of circuitry. Okay, 32 by 32, those many, 1024, 964, something like that. To avoid this expense, one can compute the product in sequential identical steps. So multiplication up to natural unsigned. So we are paying attention to unsigned number, not signed number. Okay, simplest way of calculating the product z equal to xy in a sequence of steps is to add y multiplicand to partial sum x times. So basically, the multiplicand is getting added to itself x number of times, where x is the value of the multiplier. Now we need an invariant. Invariant means a predicate that will hold good at the start of any operation and end of any operation. So that means normally, whenever as algorithm designer, you have to propose an algorithm that some invariant expression should be there, which should hold good at the beginning of the operation, at the beginning of each expression, each sub expression, at the end of that, and also at the beginning of the entire operation at the end. So that invariant expression must hold good, whatever expression, whatever algorithm you talk about. So here the invariant expression that we have chosen is a predicate p xy or xy plus z equal to xy. This arithmetic addition. Z is the partial sum, capital X is the multiplier, y, capital Y is the multiplicand. And xy at any point of time, okay, this is dynamical. To start with, let us say, x equal to, given the, say, multiplier, but y equal to 0, so then it will be 0, right? So that means you see, this is the ultimate desired value, z equal to xy. You can visualize that xyz stands for some register, okay, some storage elements. So finally, this storage element should be for 4-bit number, it's 8-bit register, z. It should give me that's what we require. And talk about the completeness of algorithm, the correctness of the algorithm, such predicates or invariant expression will be essential. And now let me propose the algorithm. Algorithm is this. Okay, this is the initial assignment. That means a register, you are loading the multiplier, you are loading another register y with the multiplicand, and there is another register which is initialized to 0. Obviously, it should be 8-bit if these are 4-bits. Okay, the first algorithm I propose is this. I load it, is the initial assignment. Then there is a while do loop. Okay, see the sequential operation, as I told you, an identical step. So within the while do loop, what is there? Just decrement x, you do nothing, and z equal to some adder. So you require hardware. You can understand what I require. I require a 4-bit full adder, and I require a counter, because decrementing is, I need a counter. Okay, so, and counter is also a register because it consists of array of flip flops. So result follows from p and x equal to 0. Then z equal to xy. Now this is a very simple, innocent algorithm. Okay, simplest form. Above algorithm is simple but inefficient. Why? Because number of states required is x, which may be large. Say x equal to 15. Then I require 15 steps, right? So huge amount of time will be consumed. Very slow, slowest. Although the hardware is simple, I require a 4-bit adder, I require a 4-bit counter, nothing else. We therefore have to find a step that decreases x more rapidly. So x is, instead of decreasing x by 1 at each step, can I make it more rapid? That means, say, x and the next step becomes x by 2, then it becomes x by 4, something like that. Halving the operation. And halving operation means x by 2 means you have to shift it towards right. Because you have to think of the hardware. We require a hardware. Whatever algorithm we propose, that should be implementable by using a hardware. Okay? Right? So pair of operation that we have to be concerned with is the halving operation. X divided by 2 and y equal to 2 star y. Okay? So that's why if you do it together, you see that xy remains the same. Once you are dividing by 2, x by 2, you multiply out xy, it gets you xy. That's what we are dealing with in the earlier steps also. But there is a but. That is what? Initially, if you have to divide it properly, some quotient should there with zero remainder, the x should be initially even. Okay. Otherwise, some remainder will be there and you cannot track this. So it is required. So what we do, we specify the algorithm in this form. Please read up. What do we written algorithm 2? It is more efficient than 2. Why we say more efficient? Why we say it is more efficient, anyone? Efficiency in what terms?
So it will take less clock pulses because we are dividing by 2, so it will take log n time. Whereas the previous one took 10 time.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you. So that is the answer. Answer is that the time taken is less. That's why it is efficient, okay, compared to the original algorithm. Okay. Now, so read up the algorithm. This is the initial assignment. There is a register which is storing the value x, then y is storing the value y, and z, this is you are initializing to zero. And what is the operation that you do repeatedly? In each step is a while do loop. So if odd x, how will you know whether a number is odd or even? How do you know for a digital number? I have taken that 30 students are absent today, 100, so the remaining 30 will not be able to sit in my class test on the 31st. Please let know, because attendance list I can easily get from Microsoft Teams. So please remember that I will not allow the persons who are absent in the second class test. Let it be clear. Okay. So the repeated steps that will be taken is that, what was the answer? How do you know is a multi-bit number is odd or even? By looking at the which bit?
LSB.
Very good. LSB. Yeah. So least significant bit, if it is 1, I know that number is odd. If it is 0, I know that number is even. So if it is an odd number, then I need to do this operation, decrementing the counter, adding up. Otherwise, what you will do, when you go down the step, so automatically the division and this. So I require less number of steps. Earlier, I require, say, depending on the value of x, so x was initialized. So 15, the maximum number, I require 15 steps. But here, not more than, say, if the number is, say, 1000, okay, or whatever, I require. I have to divide by 2 means I have to shift it towards right, so maximum 4. Okay. Following third algorithm is even better suited for implementation on a simple computer. It relies on the fact, you see, here, suppose the maximum number is 1111. So if you halve it, okay, so I'll go to, less than 7 number of times. But the third algorithm, why I say it is even better than the second one, it relies on the fact that numbers are represented by a fixed number n of bits. Okay, so it means, relies on the fact that numbers are represented by a fixed number n of bits, suppose n equal to 4, then it requires exactly n steps, not more than that. That is the maximum number of times the algorithm needs to be executed. As having the largest representable multiplier n times reduces it to 0, basically each time having means shifting right by 1 bit position. So you can reduce it to 0, n number of times. Okay. So it requires exactly n steps. Okay. Finally, it will reduce it to 0 after n steps. Clear? Advantage of this algorithm is that both x and z are being divided. Let me specify the algorithm. Here only x was divided, not z. And if you shift it towards the same direction, I will ask you what is the benefit. Remember, both x and z are being divided or shifted in the same direction. How why I say that it is an advantage. We introduce a further variable I to count the number of steps. Although I know that it will be maximum n. So if n equal to 4, maximum number of times it will be executed is 4 to count the number of steps and use the modified invariant. Read the modified invariant. I write a p prime 2 to the power n xy plus z equal to 2 to the power I xy. These xy n are constant, these xy are variable. Okay, and this is another second part of this predicate in the form of an inequality. X is greater than equal to 0 and less than 2 to the power I. And the triple up assignments, the 2-3 assignments we require. Okay, these are within the, this is not initial assignments, mind you. This will be involved within the algorithm. Achha, so what is the benefit? What is the convenience? If X and Z are being divided, it is shifted in the same direction. Just imagine and tell me. Why do I say it is a benefit? Because, see, you can have a long register. X can be a part, Z can be a part, okay? So if both of them have to divide it by 2, that means both of them will be shifted out. So I have a benefit that if I place Z on the left hand side, X on the right part of a long register, say 8-bit register, initially X will occupy the 4 bits, okay? Z will be initially 0. And then as you, Z will finally come to occupy 8 bits, but X can be made to vanish after the operation is done. So in each step, X will lose 1 bit, that means X will be shrinking, Z will be expanding. Okay, let me show. So this is the algorithm. This is the initial assignment. A register is loaded with the value of the multiplier. Okay, Z is initialized to 0 and you initialize a counter. And within the repeat step, what you are doing, if odd X, that means the least significant bit is 1, then Z equal to Z plus 2 to the power n y. This is basically what we are doing. Addition of 2 to the power n y means, don't get afraid. So 2 into y means what? I'm shifting it once towards left. 2 square 2 means I'm shifting it left towards by 2 bits. So n bits means I'm shifting it by 4 bits. As simple as that. Okay, nothing to worry. And Z equal to Z 2, just I'm right shifting. So the entire step consists of nothing but adding and shifting. Okay, the repeated statements are called add shift step. And in digital computer, this is very convenient. Okay, that means if we can specify an algorithm in terms of only adding and shifting, that means the adder is the only number crunching element. Other is only shifting. Shifting means towards the right or left. Shift registers are easily available. One can verify the desired result by the following implications. From I equal to 0, so this is just a way of saying that this predicate is correct for our application. So this is simple, you can read it up. From I equal to 0 and this one, second part, I conclude that X equal to 0. Okay, because X was initialized to X and finally I is decremented. So if you started with N, then at each step it is decremented, N minus 1, N minus 2. After n traversal of this loop, repeat until loop, I will become 0. So when I become 0, X will definitely be 0. Okay, because X is also divided by 2, means shifting towards the right, and it will require at most n steps. Clear? So one, as X becomes 0, then if you look at the invariant, so X becomes 0, Z equal to, and I equal to 0, so Z equal to XY. That's what we require, that finally the register Z should get me the product. Note here, addition of this is achieved that I have told you. Predicate odd X is determined by the least significant. That also you know. Now, let me take you to the hardware. It's very simple. You will be surprised. Since the product of two n-bit numbers, okay, here for simplicity n equal to 4, requires 2 n bits for its correct representation. And Z, which will accommodate the final 8-bit product, how many bits it will require? Z obviously requires a register of double the length. What do you mean by that? Say X and Y, they will require 4 bits. Z is supposed to store the final product which consists of 8 bits. So it will require a register of double length, that means 8 bits. One can implement this algorithm using, in addition to the double register for Z, only one register for Y by storing the multiplication that will remain constant. And also see that solution lies in sharing the double register for both Z and X. That's what we have been telling you. See, I made a statement here that advantage of this algorithm is that both x and z are being divided, that is shifted in the same direction. So it allows me to put x and z in the same register, though on the different portions. Z will be on the left side, right, x on the right side. Now I'll illustrate the scheme where a left part of the double register is shown to be occupied by the partial sum z and its right part by the multiplier x. Register M is called the multiplier register. See, first I show you that assume that n equal to 4, then I'll require an 8-bit register. Okay, where the left half part is consisting of z. So at the very first, yeah, z is initialized to 0 and x is the 4-bit multiplier. Next, dynamically, some intermediate state I am showing where z, you see, it has expanded. X has become shrunk. Size of the this part, right up part is shrinking, decreasing, whereas the left part, it is increasing. Finally, at the end of the algorithm, when the algorithm is terminated, then z will come to occupy the entire 2n bit or 8 bit portion. Okay, so these are the multiplication states using registers R, M, and so I require 3 registers. Basically, R and M constitute a single 8 bit register. For Y, I have got a separate 4 bit register. And see the operation also. From the operation, you can get me to the, you can take me to the architecture. So you see that Z and X, Z is initialized to 0. Here, multiplier is 11, 1, 0, 1, 1. And multiplicand is 13, 1, 1, 0, 1. Final product should be 13 multiplied by 11, that is 143. 8 bit. It has to be accommodated too. So this is the, see all of you, this is the multiplicand. How comes the multiplicand? Here. So just look at the algorithm. Yeah, algorithm, where is the algorithm? Yeah. First of all, odd x. Because multiplier is 1011. So as 1 is shifted out, 1 is the odd number 1011. So you have to add up this. And add up means 2 to the power 4. So basically 2 to the power 4 means you are just left shifting by 4. So this is the left shift. And the multiplicand is multiplied by 2 to the power 4 and added up. So every time, see, n is constant. So each time, the adder will send the data in the 4 bits here, in the 4 bits here, at all point of time. Because only the multiplicand is multiplied by 2 to the power 4 and it will be brought here. And multiplicand is 13, 1101, so it is coming here. Okay. Next, what you do is shift. Shift means right shift. Look at this. Z equal to z div 2, x equal to x div 2. That means you are shifting towards right by 1 bit position. So as you shift it here, it goes from, this 0 is what? This is the carry output. Okay, carry output is 0, so you shift the 5 bits here. In fact, all 9 bits you are shifting towards the right. Okay, this also gets shifted. So having shifted, that means you get a long shift register. Okay, including the carry out, it will be a 9 bit shift register. So every or the entire shift register, you shift towards the right and fill up the left most part by 0. It is not required actually. Finally, the carry output will come here. Okay, so that means 1101, 10, as it right shifts by 1 bit position, this one comes here, this one comes here, this 0 goes here, finally this, and this 1 is left out, it's shifted out. Okay, it gets lost. Next, you scan this. Okay, if again it is odd x, I know that you have got it. Right, 1101, the least significant is again 1. So then you have to add it up once more with the multiplicand. So this is what is the decimal value? 0110, that means 6. And the multiplicand is 13, 1101. So 13 plus 6 gives me 19. And 19 in binary form will be represented in this fashion. 10011. Clear? Now again, right shift by 1 bit position, that means this 9 bit is right shifted, it results in a 8 bit number. This 1 comes here, this 0 comes here, this 0 comes here, and so on. Finally, this 1 gets lost. Now, however, the least significant bit is 0, so it is an even number. Look at the algorithm. If it is odd x, then only do the sum. If it is even x, do not carry out the sum, but straight away you come to the shifting state. So this is the add step, this is the shifting state. Add and decrement, of course. Here, actually, what you are doing, you are shifting and then decrementing the counter. Clear? So here, no addition. That means it remains the same. Earlier it was 1001. Now also, you add up 0, so 1001. It remains the same. However, shifting will take place. So this 9-bit number will shift. This 0 will come here. This 1 will come here, and so on. This 0 will be left out, and 1. Finally, again, this 1, this number is a odd number. So because LSB is 1, so you need to add one more final time. So look at the value. 1 followed by 30 followed by 1 will give me, what is the value? Sorry, this is actually 4. So 4 plus 13 will give me 17. Okay, 13 is the multiplicand, mind you, 1101. So 4 plus 13 will give me 17. 17 can be represented by this 5-bit number 1001. And you do the shifting once again, you get the final product 1000111. So again, why do you get 143? So these 4 ones give me 15, and this is 128, okay? The weightage, you know, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128. So 128 plus 15, this will give me 143. And 143 is the desired product, right? And as far as the hardware is concerned, that also I can show you, very simple hardware. That means I require, total, I require a 9-bit register, and this is connected. That means R, this register R for storing the result maybe, and this M stands for the multiplier. So multiplier is initialized with the multiplier value here, 10. In this example, it is 1011. So you load 1011 here. There should be a, what you call, in the actual hardware, there can be a multiplexer, okay, which stores the initial value to M. And after that, M did not be initialized, it takes the value from the left, okay. So for that, it may be needed. So that means multiplier is loaded here, and this is initialized to 0, okay? And first time you find it to be 1, so just add this multiplicand. Multiplicand is coming, and load the 4-bit sum to here, and the carry out will be sent here. Carry out can be 1 or 0 at different points of time. That's why I require a flip-flop here. And then the entire 9-bit shift register, I'm shifting towards the right. Clear? This is the one. X, I write separately z equal to z div to x equal to, but as z and x are parts of the same register, so they will be shifted out. Okay. But the full control will require a multi, what? What do you require? Let me ask you one question. Is the hardware sufficient, or do I need anything extra? Anyone? Do I require anything extra? Exactly. So that is one thing. Okay. That odd even checking part you require. Anything anything more? Just think carefully and tell. Exactly. So I need to track the number of times it is this repetitive process goes on. So what do I normally require to keep the track? See, I have initialized this and this is decrementing. I require a presetable
counter.
Very good. A presetable down counter. Okay, that I'll require. In fact, in the next laboratory experiment, I'll ask you to do this. So that means this, I require a presetable down counter. I have to initialize it once, then at the each step, I have to decrement it by one. So this is the hardware. Actually, this hardware suffices for the data path only. I require a control path also. Okay. So note that addition will be performed only when the bit shifted out on the right. That means the least significant bit of the register is 1, found to be 1. Okay. Now, do you have any doubt? You can ask me. So, any doubt? Let me know. Okay, so we have discussed about the PAL and multiplier today. So any doubt you can let me know, I'll answer. Or you have got
it? Sir, I have a doubt.
Yes, please.
Sir, in PLA circuits, do we have hazards? I mean, in logic circuits, the hazard was due to the delay of the gates. So in PLA circuits, what is the cause of the delay and how it happens?
Okay, that means every combinational gate has got a inherent delay. Okay, as you are computing any sum of product operation, the different AND gates have got their different delays. Now, as you are combining the AND terms, okay, and there is a, that means suppose two AND terms are there, and that means two AND gates are there, and they are also finally OR. Now, if the two AND terms, the AND gates actually take care of that distinct minterms, and there is a neighboring, the two minterms are neighboring, which involve a change of variable, only one variable. That means suppose x3, x2, x1, x0, four variables are there. I go from x3, x1, AND gate takes care of x3, x2, x1, x0 bar, and I take x3, x2, x1, x0. So x0 is present in one AND term in complemented form, in other is uncomplemented. Now, it is required that for some input assignment, it is required that x0 has a change from 0 to 1. Okay, so due to some operation, some input assignment. So in that case, when x0 changes from 0 to 1 or vice versa, it can be other way also, that due to the inverter, the one AND gate can have a more delay than the other one. So for what you call the logic 1, as that what you talk about is that one, finally the output should be 1, but as one AND gate is speedier in operation than the other gate, so and there, suppose x0 has changed from 1 to 0, then the output of this AND gate will become 0, and there will cause a glitch. That means a momentary appearance of logic 0 has come. In order to avoid that, what you will do, that although the two neighboring min terms are taken care of by two distinct AND gates, what we do, we bring in the circuit one redundant AND gate, which will combine the two midterms. Okay, if we do that, what will happen? Its output will, as x0 has lost its appearance from that AND gate, the third AND gate. So now, even though x0 changes from 1 to 0, 0 to 1, its output of that AND gate will remain 1. So this will remove the glitch. So in PLA also, as PLA is a tool, actually, it is not the question of PLA, but rather as we are doing any sum of product hardware, as you are dealing with, unless there is a chance of the logic one hazard. But that is probabilistic. I mean, not always it will happen. Most of the time, if you want to reduce the number of gates, and you say that my sampling will be at a fixed amount of time. So after I'll allow sufficient time for the hazard to die out. See, hazard cannot remain finally. Hazard is temporary, momentary. It will be there for certain amount of time. After that, it will vanish. Now, suppose you are sampling at all moments of time, you do not want any particular, what you call, glitch, then you can do away with that. Or by mistake, the sampling time happens to be at the same point of time where the glitch has come to appear, then there can be a misinterpretation. Otherwise, if we allow sufficient time to stabilize, for the output to stabilize, then I do not require the redundant gate. So, hazard, if you talk about, you think in terms of sum of what you call two level sum of product realization by using AND gates in the one level followed by OR gates. Okay, so PLA also has got PLA or PROM or PAL, whoever they all. I mean, we are talking about two level AND OR gates. In case of two level OR AND combination, you have to think of logic zero hazard. Okay, well, sorry, that will be logic one hazard, because momentary logic one will appear, right? And then finally it will die down to zero. So the two distinct static hazard we have to take, whether we are doing sum of product or product of sum, and they will be everywhere. So if we are very much, what you call, if that bothers us that no glitch should be there, then we go for removing any that means all pair of neighboring min terms or neighboring max terms, neighboring min terms should be combined in the form of a redundant AND gate. Neighboring max term should be combined in the form of a superfluous or redundant OR gate. Okay, then you have to incur the extra cost of that AND gate or OR gate. Otherwise, simply do not bother. Okay, so it is not the question of PLA, but it is a question of whether we are going for sum of product realization, whether you require some extra AND gate or product of some implementation, thereby whether you require some additional OR gate. Clear?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Himadri. So, any more doubt? Acha. So, let me, before we speak, let me wish all of you a very happy Dasera and Durga Puja. So, please try to remain indoors with your family, okay? And if we go outdoors, please take the maximum precaution, okay? Please wear mask, do not forget mask and even head shield. And also, please keep one hand sanitizer in your pocket. So, take utmost care of your health, okay? Because you are the most precious, citizens, okay? So, please take utmost care of your health and also remind others to maintain this, safety precautions, okay? So, once again, wishing all of you a very happy holiday, although very restricted time, only 5 days we have got a holiday. So, anyway, I wish all of you a very fabulous time, but please enjoy keeping health of your own and your family members, your friends also in your mind. Okay. Is there any doubt? Please let me know. You can send me emails also. So, please remember the 31st October, that means the Saturday, it will be class day. So, I hope it will be not a problem for anyone. Is not? 3:30 you can attend the class day. Okay. So, I believe yes, any doubt? And let me tell you, this semester is very compressed, okay? So, after that multiplier we have studied, I don't know whether I'll be able to accommodate the divider. If possible, I'll discuss in the next class, but we have to next take up the sequential circuits, okay? So far, if any doubt is there, do not hesitate. You send me by email, I'll be happy to answer.
Someone has written something on the chat, yes. I think Anish.
Chat box I could see. Let me see. Sir, would you please take attendance once more today? I had an unstable network. Okay, sure. And Anish, sir, in the PLA, is that based on only static? Yes, exactly. Well, let me take the attendance first. Participants, downloaded. So, you are always uppermost in our mind. So, please be attentive in the class. That is for your own benefit also. Okay, so... Yeah, so as we said, the whether you employ PLA or PROM or PAL, you have to think of what kind of operation you are doing. Okay, so for programmable polarity, it can be POS. For otherwise, it is mostly SOP. Okay, so SOP means that the static one and glitch. That is whether you need to consider or not. It always remember that this removal of static one hazard or static zero hazard, most of the time it is due to academic or pedagogic interest. In normal real time, if you have to take care of, say we are dealing with 5 or 6 variables maximum in our classroom exercise, okay. But in industrial scale problems, you have to deal with say 50 variables, 100 variables, something like that. So there, if you have to take care of all the logic one, logic zero hazard very acutely, then you will run heavy cost, okay. And suppose there are some life critical applications, I don't know, there maybe you have to take care of the hazards. More important hazards are there, like dynamic hazards, and also if we have occasion to study about asynchronous sequential circuit, we can study about hazard more, but I don't know whether I'll be able to discuss that because time is very limited, okay. As you know, this semester will have to be wound up by 20th of November, okay, so time is very limited in our hand. So anyway, we'll be in touch always, don't worry. So you have, I think you have analog communication class now, no? Now, what is the next class or electromagnetic engineering? I am forgetting. So I think electromagnetic engineering or analog communication, right? So you have to run to the next class. Thank you very much, okay, all of you, enjoy. Okay, can we say goodbye now?
Goodbye, sir. Goodbye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, all of you.